In this lecture, we are going to talk about the spondylolisthesis. Spondylolisthesis is a common cause for low backache, radiculopathy, and neurologic eradications among the adult populations. Spondylolisthesis means anterior flipping or anterior translation of one vertebra over the other with superimposed spinal segment. I mean, when some vertebra slip forward, or not only this vertebra will slip alone, all of the spine segment with that vertebra will slip anteriorly forward. So not only this vertebra will come to the front, but all of the vertebra which is carried by this vertebra above it will slip forward. Usually occur in the L4 and L5 lumbar vertebra around 10%, and around 90% occur in the L5 and S1 lumbar vertebra. The normal locking mechanism which existed inside the spine, I mean the lamina and the ligaments and the facet joints especially, will prevent the slipping of one vertebra over the other. When these normal restraints will break off by any means, so in that positions, in that situation, when the normal restraints are not working quite well, so in that situation only, the vertebra will slip forward. So many classifications for spondylolisthesis. The causative, the etiological classification according to the Wilsey et al. We have got the first type, congenital or dysplastic spondylolisthesis, which is entirely occur at L5 and S1 lumbar vertebra. There might be an associated other dysplastic and other abnormalities like spina bifida. It constitutes around 20% of all of the cases of spondylolisthesis. Here, the superior sacral facet is not normal. There is an oval shape and the superior aspect of the sacrum. So there will be slow, inexorable slip by time because the facet joints, which is one of the important locking mechanism that prevent slipping of the vertebra, is not working well. The other variety is called isthmic or lytic, or the other name will be spondylolisthesis. This accounts around 50% of the cases. Usually occur in the Caucasian population with weight lifters or gymnasticists, usually occur after age of 7 years or adolescent, and it is usually this type of spondylolisthesis present in 5% of all of the population. Here we have got what's called breakage of the pars interarticularis. What's pars interarticularis? Is the area just beyond, just inferior to the, in the lamina, just inferior to the superior articular process from these, from both sides, from the right and the left, there will be break. So either there is a break due to the repetitive stress fracture, or there will be elongation of this part and replacement by fibrous tissue, not working well, or acute trauma sometimes will lead to the pars fracture. When there is a pars fracture, there will be no more any connection between the upper and the lower vertebra, except in the discus plate, which is not quite enough to make these vertebra connect together in a good way. So there will be progressive slip of the vertebra above over the one below. The pathological any pathology that leads to the destruction of a bone, into the amount that these restraints, I mean the patent of and the lamina, will not be a good restraint for slippage, so it will lead to the spondylolisthesis, like any infection or tumor occur in the posterior element and lead to the disruption of the lamina and the facet joint. So the normal restraints for spondylolisthesis is not there, and progressive slipping will occur. Traumatic one, when any trauma lead to the breakage of the lamina and the facet joints, will lead to the breakage of the normal restraint that binds one vertebra with the other, also lead to the spondylolisthesis. Arthrogenic by the surgeon, when the surgeon is doing extensive laminectomy and or facetectomy and not respecting the normal restraints and locking mechanism that binds one vertebra to the other, in that situation also spondylolisthesis might occur after the surgery. The clinical presentation history at the first will be according to the age of presentation. In the child, there will be a peculiar stance and protruded abdomen. Adolescent and young adult will present with the backache, which is intermittent, and claudications. In the degenerative one, the patient over the age of 50 years usually present with the mild backache, sciatica, neurogenic claudication due to the features of the spinal stenosis when the vertebra slip anteriorly. There might be associated vasico rectal disorders if the slippage is severe enough to do traction of the lower nerve roots. The patient also might present with the features of radiculopathy, I mean diminished sensation and weakness in the affected dermatomes and myotomes. And usually the L5 nerve root is much more affected and tracted and compressed. And the second most common nerve root will be the L4 nerve root. Examination should be conducted in the systematic way. In the outset, we should look at the gait. If there is a severe traction and severe compression on the lower nerve roots, the patient might present with a foot drop. We should look for any loss of the normal lumbar lordosis. And we should look for the flat buttock, in which the sacrum will extend to the weight. If there is any associated scoliosis, should be looked for. We should also look for the transverse low increase in the back. So any child with flat back, protruded abdomen, overweight, a transverse low increase in the back is pathognomonic for spondylolisthesis. We might also observe hip flexion contractures, muscle atrophy due to the weakness. On feeling, on the spinous processes downward, you might feel a step off in the listitic level. Range of movement is usually not affected, and occasionally sometimes there is hypermobility. Hamstring tightness might be observed. Neurological examination in the proper way should be conducted, searching for any diminished sensation and weakness in the affected dermatomes and myotomes. Regarding the imaging studies, lumbar AP, lateral and oblique views should be conducted. Also, the lateral flexion and extension view on the supine position. Because if you take a lateral flexion and extension view on supine position, when you ask the patient to bend forward, he or she's going to bend the hips instead of the spine, and this is by in turn will mask the spine flexion. So the operator will control the patient on the table and flex the spine forward. By this can unmask any contribution of the hip movement to the spine movement. As sometimes the slip will be obvious on the flexion view and return back to the normal in extension view. The oblique view will show the break of pars interarticularis. So in the X-ray, as I will show you in the next slides, there will be breakage in the neck of the Scotty dog, which represent the pars interarticularis. As I mentioned, it's the area just inferior to the superior articular process of each vertebra. MRI investigation sometimes mandatory if the patient have got a neurological finding, and CT scan for sure will show the break of the pars much more obvious than the any other modalities of investigation. On the lateral view, you will see the degree of the slip, and this lateral X-ray is used to for another type of the classification, which is the degree of slippage. It's called the Meridian classification. The grade 1 slip will be up to 25% of the vertebra above is slipped on the vertebra below, grade 2 up to 50%, and grade 3 up to 75%, grade 4 up to 100%, and grade 5 it's called spondyloptosis, when there is no any contact between the upper end plate and lower one. So it's more than 100% displacement. This is the feature of the Scotty or illusory duck. So the X-ray film in the oblique view will be like that, at 20% of the break in the Scotty dog or spondylolysis will be obvious in the oblique views. So in the X-ray you will see some break in the neck of the Scotty dog. Here's the scene. I think this is an X-ray, and I think it's not difficult to see the feature of the dog right here. Around 2.5 dog right here, you can see the mouth, the ear, and the neck of the dog, the foot, and the leg of the foot. All are obvious right here. The breakage of the neck of the dog or pars interarticularis in the red line in the upper two slides are quite obvious. This is also, if you are going to see it with the X-ray, it will be much more obvious. Here you can see the in the upper right one, the both, really the both is spondylolisthesis. The first one is grade 1, and the in the right is grade 1, and the in the left it's a grade 2 to 3, 2.5. Slippage according to the Meridian classifications, and the slippage of the pars is quite obvious between the L5 and S1 lumbar vertebra. Regarding the prognosis, is according to the type of the listhesis. In the dysplastic one, appear early in the age, as I mentioned, it's congenital, and it will progress quite early to the severe grade. And if there is any progressive neurological finding in the patient, it should be fixed in situ. Regarding the lytic one or isthmic or spondylolysis, if it is less than 10% slippage, usually there might be no any symptoms. It's usually not progress to the severe, much more sleep, and not lead to the later backache, and it's not a contraindication for activity. But if the slip is more than 25, usually progress much more severe and much more early, and lead to the neurological complication and should be fixed. Regarding the degenerative one, usually present at the age more than the age of 50 years old, progress slowly, and usually if it does not progress more than 30% of the slip, need no any kind of surgical management, just conservative management is fair enough. Provided that we don't have a clear-cut indication for surgical management, which we will talk about, So we should conduct always an non-operative and conservative management, which includes 2 to 3 days of rest with a short course and of anti-inflammatory medication with analgesia. Physiotherapy will help to strengthen the back muscles, spinal support and braces sometimes needed in the acute setting of the pain in the back, modification of the activity and job sometimes is one line of management. Psychological support of the patient and the family is quite important in the setting of the conservative management, and epidural injections sometimes help in masking the signs and symptoms for a long period sometimes. As we all know that the decision is much more important than incision, and we should never forget the proverb of do no harm. If you think that your surgery is not in the benefit of the patient, and you should not harm your patient, you should always think about our goals, which are pain reduction, improvement of the neurological symptoms if the patient have. By these two, we are going to improve the quality of the life in the patient's life. If you are sure that you are not going to get these aims and goals, so you should keep on your conservative management and don't harm your patient. The indication of the surgery will be Cowden equina syndrome, which is an absolute indication, progressive neurological deficit. On the serial follow-up, you see that the grade of the muscle power and the sensation is much more worse. If you have got a slip, according to the medical classification, more than 50 degrees, and it was progressive on the serial follow-up, persistent radiculopathy, which is, there's dimensional sensation and weakness in the affected dermatomes and myotomes, which is not responding to any modality of conservative management, epidural injections. Persistent and unremitting low back pain for more than 6 months. For more than 6 months when the patient is under a good, reliable conservative management, but still have got a low backache and cannot enjoy his normal life and normal activities with that. Disabling symptoms that affect the job and the work of the patient, or normal sport of the patient, is also can be an indication for surgery, and should all be explained to the patient, and any points and pros of that surgery should be explained quite well to the patient and the family. Regarding the type of the surgery, when the patient have got compression on the nerve root, nowadays no one is accepting the compression alone, because already the spine is unstable and there's a slip. So by whatever the type of decompression you do, even you are going to do flavectomy, you are going to do more destabilization of the spine. So you cannot do decompression never alone. You should also fix if you did any decompression, although it has been mentioned that it's allowed only in the degenerative one. If you do by microscope and just flavectomy and foraminotomy, there's a lot of controversy on that. Majority of the authors are not accepting that. Regarding the laminectomy and posterior spinal fusion, without instrumentation is also mentioned, it's not accepted. Because you should support your fusion, like the long bones, if you have got a fractured tibia. While waiting for a fusion, you should put a plate until the bone heals, either by callus or by direct fusion. They heal the same. If you are going to do laminectomy and decompression and fusion, you should support your fusion with the fixation by transpedicular screws. Sometimes you need some patients, some surgeons go anterior and do quite a good discectomy with and putting a cage between the vertebra to get a good fusion. So either you do from anterior approach or posterior approach. From the posterior, you should do all of the session together. So decompression and or reduction, fixation and fusion. So either you do intertransverse fusion, you put a bone graft between the transverse processes, or best you do a TLIF, which is called a transforamen lumbar interbody fusion, when you put a cage, a large cage, posteriorly through the intervertebral foramina, or you go anterior and excise all of the disc space and put a very large disc. So you should always fix and fuse and decompress and or reduce if the patient favors reduction and you think that your reduction will not more compromise the nerve roots. So either you do fixation in situ or you do reduction and fixation with the polyreduction screws, a type of the transpedicular screws. The X-ray on the right side show L5 and L1 lumbar fixation and fusion with the TLIF, transforaminal lumbar interbody cage. The photo on the left shows a three-level fixation and intertransverse fusion. What about if spondylolisthesis occurred after trauma? So sometimes the patient gets trauma, gets fracture of the lamina, fracture of the facet, so the normal restraint, the normal locking mechanism that binds the vertebra together will be lost by the trauma. As we mentioned, the traumatic type of spondylolisthesis, we put the patient on the spinal brace for 3 months and re-examine the patient by X-ray and by CT scan. If there were fusion, so the spondylolisthesis was due to the trauma, and it should heal by the 3 months. If after 3 months the X-ray finding and the CT scan finding show that there is still a gap in the fracture site, so this gap was available already prior to the trauma, and it is not due to the trauma, and it is treated according to the same lines as we mentioned before. And thank you very much.